The rest of us, if you take your Bibles, the book of Luke, chapter 15 this morning. Luke, chapter number 15. As we continue what ends up being a three-week, it was supposed to be one message, and now a three-week series through the story of what many call the prodigal son, we have chosen to call it the prodigal God. And we talk about it because we look at a lot of culture. We look at the fact that really the way the father in this story responded, which is the picture of God, is reckless. It's ridiculous because there's so many things he could have and should have done. And culturally today, probably we would have done. So this morning, I hope that we can be encouragement. And that's really the goal. By the way, a lot of times when you hear messages like this, the prodigal son and all this, at least for me, you get nervous. Okay, they're going to rip us up, make us feel guilty. That's not the goal. All right, it's not at all the goal because all of us at some point can look at the story and say, I find myself here. Can I tell you, I'm going to quickly jump to the end. We'll deal with this more next week, but I'm going to jump to the end for just 3-4 seconds, all right? No matter how you look at the other two brothers, when it's all said and done, God's love was unconditional to them and nothing they could do would ever make God love them less. I think that's the part we need to see. No matter, he depicted two really rough perspectives of sons and yet showed love to both of them. There's nothing we can do to make God love us less than he does now. Nothing we can do to make him love us more than he does now. That is the ultimate point of what we're looking at. Let's read the passage. You follow along as I read, beginning in verse 11 of Luke chapter 15. The Bible says, and he said, a certain man, this is Jesus speaking, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that followed to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto the father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight am I no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his other son was in the field. And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandments, yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive, and was lost and is found. Our Father, we thank you for the privilege to study your word. And Lord, to look at a passage that has so much in it for us today. Father, I pray as we not only examine the culture and the reasons behind what much of what Jesus was saying, but what it means to us today. May you encourage us. I pray for those searching for the truth of heaven. Father, would you help them to find it today? Would you help them to see your love and how much you love them, despite who they are, anything. Lord, some are new to church. Some have been in church most of their life. It doesn't change your view of either one of them. And Father, may they focus upon you and grow closer to you today in this time. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to take a little bit of just a moment and give a little bit of introduction for those who maybe weren't here last week and kind of break down instead of just jumping in to the older brother. As we look at this, we understand that the father, we see these two brothers. Now, by the way, I guess I must start with this. This is a parable, which means a story. In the parable, each person in the story depicts somebody he's talking to. The younger brother depicts earlier in the chapter before, there were sinners and publicans who had sought out Jesus. They knew who they were. They weren't trying to deny the fact that they were considered evil by the religious people. And they sought Jesus out to seek the truth and the grace that he's shown. And so while he's there, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, the priests, the preachers of the day, began to mock and criticize Jesus for hanging out with sinners. How dare they? Because see, they had understood that one of the things that made them as religious people so spiritual was their refusal to spend time with, as they would call it, sinners. Now, can I take a second to explain to you? That actually, in of itself, is pretty big sin. What would that sin be? Pride. For me to look at anybody else in this area, Bensalem, Levittown, Philadelphia, Langhorne, Croydon, Feasterville, and all the different places that we could go, for me to ever look at anybody and say, man, I'm glad I'm not like them, is spitting in the face of Jesus because they were created by God. It's prideful on my part. Who am I? There was the publican and the sinner, and the Pharisee was praying, I'm glad I'm not as this guy. And Jesus says he didn't leave with any repentance. He wasn't forgiven. But the publican sat there and pounded his chest and asked, Lord, forgive me. See, God makes it clear that he looks on the heart. He doesn't look on the outward appearance. And so Jesus is with the sinners and he's with these people and he's talking to them. He's sharing his love. And then all of a sudden the Pharisees come over and Jesus yet kind of preaches at the Pharisees and he gives three parables. And this is the third. Remember, this is very, very important when looking at the story. Jesus is preaching to the Pharisees. Right? Here's what happens. Inevitably this happens. You bring up the story of the prodigal son. Somebody will make this comment. Well, the older brother had an awful lot to be mad at. I mean, I don't blame him. Inevitably, it's what happens. I mean, think about it. He stayed in church. He's the good guy. That's how it's said. He's the good guy. I mean, come on. And then I heard someone a few weeks ago said, he's us in church. And I looked at the person and said, I hope not. I hope not. Because he's the one that Jesus is preaching to. And here's what happens. Here's what's happening. We're taking the parable of the prodigal son, and instead of looking at it from the culture which Jesus desired to be there, we're kind of twisting it to fit 21st century church. All right? We say that the Pharisee or the older brother is the guy who never left church and always served and always did right and always was the good kid. And we say the prodigal son was the guy who ran away from church and got saved but didn't stick around and left and he came back and we're glad he's here. That's not what this parable is talking about. Understand, both of the brothers in the story are unsaved. The actual context of this story, both brothers are unsaved, and he's talking about what keeps them from coming. The ultimate goal is that he says, you Pharisees are unsaved because you don't believe in me. You sinners are unsaved, and both of you have something holding you back from the truth. Now, here's what we hold back. Really, what happens is there's the same thinking in both sides. I want freedom from God. I want freedom from rules. I want freedom from these things. And so the younger brother says, I'm going to go out in the world and live it up. And in the world, I will find freedom from the oppression of organized religion. Now, by the way, if you've been in too much organized religion, then you would understand what I mean by the oppression of it. This expectation that you have to be so good to be accepted by God. That is not how Jesus intended it to be. That is a twisted man's view to make us look good. It is not what God intended. God wants us to come as we are to him, no different than anyone else, and just accept the gift he offers. That's all he wants. But so many people are frustrated, sometimes rightfully so, with religion that they go to the world, but after a while they find themselves in a figurative pigsty. They're done, they're empty, and the world has beaten them up, and now they want to go home. And that's about the time they come home and they get saved, according to the story. The older brother, he didn't leave, but he still didn't really want to obey his father. So he said, listen, I don't have to obey because I'm good. He found his freedom from the rules in his own morality. I'm good enough. I'm better than so-and-so. And so therefore, in my own goodness, I'm free. Today we actually call that humanism. But what happens is that thinking can roll itself into churches and into Christianity today. So as we look at this idea, let me explain the definition of the term prodigals. We talk about the idea of prodigal God. The word prodigal does not necessarily mean wayward. But according to Merriam-Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, it means recklessly spendthrift. It means to spend until you have nothing left. It's appropriate, therefore, for the father, because after his younger son had wasted all that money, he forgot about it. His son comes home to probably a smaller property, less land, coming home to all of the damage that he had caused because his father had to sell all this land to give his son money. And he comes home and he sees the damage he's done still. Some people believe that the father had regained wealth. I believe it, but there's probably a good chance there's still a lot of effects, you know, of what the younger son had done by asking this request. And so culturally, the father should have been angry. The father should have literally kicked the son out of the home. Culturally, the son should have been dead to them. He said it, and then later the father said it, and culturally, he was right. But today what we want to do is we want to look at the older brother. To the older brother, let me give you descriptions of the Pharisees in those days. They saw themselves as morally good because of their good deeds and their detailed obedience to the law, to their law, because they'd added so much to God's law. They looked down on sinners because they found themselves so much better than sinners. Even though they were good or religious, they were missing something. They had based eternity in their goodness and not in Jesus. Today we're going to focus on the older brother, which would be have been acting as a religious leaders as we hear the story. And here's the premise, the thought that I hope flows through all three of these messages. God's grace and forgiveness is available for all who would receive it. Older brother this morning, let's look at two things from the older brother. First of all, we see his righteous anger. At least he thinks it's righteous. Go to verse number 25 with me again. I'm in the wrong chapter. There we go. Verse number 25 says this. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father has killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was very angry and would not go in. I love this part. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. His father didn't even wait for him. He came out and talked. And this is what we're going to talk about. So let's take a second culturally and get an understanding of why the older brother was angry. All right, let's look at this. He was angry at the father. He wasn't angry at the son, angry at the father. Can you imagine this? Now, picture the scenario. The older son has been working all day long. He comes home, probably angry, bitter, resentful, because every day he watches his father sitting up front, waiting for the younger brother to come home. Every day watching the pain that his old younger brother had caused his dad. Every day watching his dad pray for the younger brother as he's working to regain the wealth that the younger brother had wasted. I'm sure hearing all kinds of rumors from the city of his brother and the popularity and all the trash and just hoping he'd never see him again. And all of a sudden, he comes from a hard day of work and he sees a party that he's not been invited to. That's immediately frustrating, isn't it? Wait a minute. Why wasn't I invited? So he calls a servant over. What'd I miss? Your brother's home. Immediately, the older brother gets angry. Excuse me? That little rat's home? Are you kidding me? Wait till he comes out here. I'm going to teach him a thing or three. All right, get him out here. Let me see the punk. I mean, immediately angry. But that's not what angered him, actually. He says, the father has killed for him the fatted calf and had a party. Now, understand something. Meat was not eaten a whole lot in the Bible days. So for someone to take the fatted calf and eat it was one of the highest levels of celebration culturally, and it would have meant the whole city would have been invited. So the father, who should have been embarrassed by the other brother, takes another part of wealth, brings the entire family in to celebrate the wretch that is the younger brother. At least this is the older brother's point of view. And the older brother gets angry. How dare he? Now, in here, he's not angry at the younger brother. He's angry at his dad. Here's what I believe he said to his dad. This son cost you how much? This son embarrassed you. He ruined your testimony. And now he comes home and you celebrate him? What about me? That's what he's saying. What about me? It's important to understand the culture, how important, big the party was. And he said, wait a minute, you never did it for me. This is why the older brother refers to his record. He says, I've never disobeyed you. I have stayed to do what's right. I'm saying I deserve to be consulted about this. You have no rights to make this decision unilaterally. I earned this. I'm the good brother. How dare you do this without asking me? And you haven't done it for me yet. You haven't bragged on me for staying. Now, in our culture, we look at this and we say, he's right. Do me a favor. Divorce your cultural view of this story from the story. Because this is going to happen. In a second, we're going to kind of beat up on the older brother for a second, all right? And if you think you're the older brother, you're going to think I'm beating up on you. Okay, let me say something here. If you're here and you're saved, you're not the older brother, okay? To say that. This was a fake religious leader. It was not in our belief system. But there are some thinkings that he had as we kind of walk through this whole thing. Here's what happens. Now the older brother is treating his father with disdain and zero respect. He's actually treating his father the same way the younger brother did. The younger brother said, give me your money and leave. The older brother said, listen, how dare you not ask me? How dare you not do this for me? The difference is the reason and the thinking of the brother. He said, I am good. I did it right. I've been here. I deserve to act this way. You see, he became indifferent and arrogant because of his good, because of his self-righteousness. The elder brother in the parable illustrates the way of what we call moral conformity. Here's moral conformity. I go to church and I walk in and the church asks me to act a certain way. Sometimes, if you come to our church, let me tell you, from my point of view, and I hope everyone else follows this, if you come to church, you're not in a suit, you're not dressed up, we don't care. We don't, all right? Please come, and if someone gets on your case, let me know and I'll go yell at them. Okay, not really, but all right, please. I hope that as you come. But when you walk in, you see the preacher in a suit, and then it's funny, someone walks in there in jeans, t-shirts, a month later a suit. Why? Because the pastor is. That's not the reason to wear a suit, all right? But, so, that's not us. You know, there's no list somewhere where the ushers are taught, listen, all right, in about 6 weeks, we need these people dressing a certain way. All right, that's not at all the way it's supposed to be. As a matter of fact, if you never change, we don't care. We don't care about that. But, when you come in, some churches are like that. Well, you got to act a certain way, you got to dress a certain way. In fact, some churches, you got to stand up and sit down the same time a certain way. You got to fit into a mold. And if you don't fit into a mold, you're not accepted. I'll give you an illustration. About a year ago, a gentleman in our church came to us. They wanted to join. He told me a story of the church they had left. And the church had found out something from his past probably 20, 25 years ago. Somehow they found out about it. Bam, immediately. And by the way, simple in comparison. It wasn't a big deal. But they just basically eliminated him from any serving in the church. Because he didn't fit their perfect mold. So he came to me. He told me what had happened. He told me what they were upset with. And he said, what do you think about it? I said, I'm glad you're here. No, really. What do you think about this? I'm just glad you're here. We love you, brother. He is kind of waiting for there's another Baptist church. And so he comes into a Baptist church and has every right to wonder. I said, listen, honestly, we're glad you're here. We don't care about that. That was 30 years ago. I don't care if it was 30 minutes ago. We don't care about that. And it took me a little bit to convince him of that. And we're going to spend every year for the rest of his time here convincing him of that. Because that doesn't matter to us. But see, moral conformity is here. All right, I'm going to go to a strict church, and I'm going to act like these people. And if I conform to this list of rules, then I'm righteous and I'm spiritual. That's moral conformity. Can I tell you what is at the core of moral conformity? Humanism. I go to church, I act a certain way, and then I'm good. Nothing in that has anything to do with Jesus and everything to do with me. I'm good because I do right and I do this and I do that. I mean, think about it. You read what the older brother said to the son. I never did this and I never did that and you never made anything for me. The entire story was about him and what he didn't get, and he was angry about it. You see, the Pharisees of the day believed that while they were people chosen by God, which the Israeli people, Jewish people were, they could only maintain their place in his blessing and receive final salvation through strict obedience to the Bible. He said, listen, we are God's chosen people, but we have to be really good. Here's how we apply it today. If you get saved, you call upon Jesus, which is as simple as acknowledging you're a sinner, repent of your sin, and ask Jesus to save you. That's salvation. It's really that easy. And then you say, well, now that I'm saved, I got to really work hard to keep my salvation. There's nowhere in the Bible that says that. So now I have to go do a lot of good work to keep, you know, I have to work hard so that God still loves me. Can I tell you, God loves you as much now as he did a year ago. God loves us as much now in the house of God, in the church of God, than he does in the darkest place this world has to offer. He loves me as much there. I can't change that. But they thought, no, I got to act a certain way. There are innumerable varieties of paradigms, this kind of paradigm, but they all believe in putting the will of God and the standards of the community ahead of individual fulfillment. In this view, we only attain happiness and a world made right by achieving moral rectitude, by really becoming really good. Many fall at times, but of course, then we'll be judged because of how bad we are. And in our abject, intense regret, we can be right. Literally, in this view, even our failures, we must measure up. Here's what it says. Even when I fail, even when I sin, I got to make sure that my confession is good enough to be accepted by God. Okay, and you know what? I know I got saved because I cried that day. I don't remember if I cried that day. I know Jesus forgave me today because I cried. Most of us in our culture cry because we got caught. All right, that's just a fact. And it's put on to hopefully not get in as much trouble. That's pretty much what happens, all right? But that's the point. We come back and say, I have to be good enough. Can I tell you, the world screams this. Religion screams this. You know why? Because if Satan can get you to believe that, then he can get you to believe you'll never be good enough for God. Why? Try. So he's kind of ripping these older brothers. Hey, listen, you guys, you think you're so great. Simply put, they believe I'm only as good and acceptable as I am moral. The struggle is that all of what I just said becomes about me. My salvation is earned. God's acceptance is earned. Heaven is my right, not my blessing. Catch this. I'm good enough, therefore I deserve heaven. Now, catch this. God has to work for me because I earned it, deserved it, and he owes it to me. That's the thinking. So if I work my way to heaven, I'm good enough, I get to heaven, I'm not praising God. I'm sinners saying, this is all mine. I earned it. Let me ask you a question. When you're handed a paycheck, most of us get it by direct deposit today, so we don't even realize we got it, and we hope it's there. But do you walk into your boss's office that day, give him a big hug, thanks for the paycheck? Most of you bring it in and say, really? Still no raise, right? That's what we're thinking. But you don't walk in and say, man, thank you so much. When you go to Chick-fil-A, that godly, chicken food, all right? That was a godly place down the street, but it's good food, all right? But you go over there, and they give you the food, and you hand them the $400 to buy the one clump, all right? You know what I'm talking about. And I say, thank you, and they're like, my pleasure. It may not be, they're told to say that, but that's okay, all right? And you pick it up, you go, thank you so much for working so hard to make this chicken. You know what? I can't believe you gave me this chicken sandwich. They're like, you're crazy, you paid for it. Go eat the thing. That's the point. If I live my life with the idea that I have to be so good to be accepted by God, that when I am, I deserve his acceptance and there's no longer grace. Salvation is my right. Heaven is something I deserve. And it's all about me. And that's what the Pharisees thought. It's all about me. It's all about me. And I miss Jesus. So let's look at number 2, his unrecognized prison. This son was very angry because he had always done right and was never celebrated. That's as easy to make the comparison of this story to our lives, but we got to be careful. Remember, this is not a good older brother who stuck around. This is a guy who was arrogant and angry and bitter. So we look at this. We look at the fact that this whole story is about salvation, repentance. And second, remember how both of these young brothers, these young boys, needed grace, whether they thought they did or not. Same thing we do. Whether we are the younger brother who's gone away, and we come back because of all of the scars of our life, and we know we need grace. Or we're the older brother, where we finally, in our arrogance, realize we're wrong, and finally are humbled and come to Jesus. Both of them needed grace. So let's look in the last few minutes at this idea of the older brother. The brother's prison came because he believed he deserved to be treated better than what he had been treated. He worked hard. He didn't have a list of sins like the younger brother. So therefore, He deserved to be treated. He should have had the party. He should have had this. How dare God not do that? Now, when I was studying this a couple weeks ago and in reviewing it again this week, I thought, oh, that's not me. But how many times have we done that? All right, I'm going to take a step away in that same thinking. All right, move away from the Pharisee for a second to us church people. All right, and just take a second. So, you got a plan, you're following along, you're in the center of God's will, and then everything seems to fall apart. Something happens that makes no sense. It's a financial issue, it's a disease in the home, it's something you can't control. Something that overwhelms you. Something that you say, it's not fair. And it might not be fair. Personally, the moment someone says, I got cancer, it's not fair. It is one of the worst things you can hear. If you're here Wednesday night, I mentioned this. Mrs. Selinka caught me. It's Wednesday night. We're walking up the stairs over there. And she's got a big smile on her face. And she's chuckling. She says, I went to the hospital and they told me I had arthritis in my knee. She says, then they told me I had appendicitis. She says, then they came back with this test. And so, by the way, it was cancer too. I said, you need to stay away from that doctor. Man, he just keeps adding things on. She had a surgery done. They found it wasn't appendicitis, had a surgery done, and they tested the part of her body taken out, and it was cancerous, and they believe they got it all. And she goes, shoo, I'm afraid, Al. I'm afraid of, arthritis? If I get anywhere else, I'm in trouble. And I'm sitting there. She's kind of laughing at it. I'm sitting there thinking, did she just tell me what I heard she said? You know, and I've had many, unfortunately, in this church come and say, hey, pray for me, Pastor. Just found out I got cancer. There's nothing fair about that. There's nothing fair when you're a father and you watch a child struggle. I remember years ago as a son watching this, just down the street, my younger sister who at 18 passed away, she had a heart transplant and rejected it and now is buried down the street. I remember the day that they buried her. I watched my dad and I watched my mom. I never thought I'd be sitting there at that young age watching my sister. But I'll never forget, it was a sister. I wasn't a father. And to this day, when I go back, I think of what it must have been like to be there as a father. I remember that as a son. I can't imagine watching that as a father. And I remember we went back. We were actually sitting in the hospital a few days earlier. One of us kids, I don't remember. I think we said, it's just not fair. And I looked at my dad, who at that point wasn't my pastor. He was my dad. Right? And he looked, he goes, no, it's not. But never once gave us a reason, my mom or dad, a reason to think that they were angry and bitter at God. As a matter of fact, at one point they found out that my sister passed away from what ended up being a mistake on the part of a nurse, tripping over a hose, and it broke something, and then ended up being the reason she died. He had call after call after call. You can sue them. You can become rich. You can become this. You can become that. And I remember I walked into his office and was over here, and he hung up, and he's fighting tears. I'm sick of this. He told me that a lawyer just called him. He said, here's the problem. And you know what? I only say this because it was in a room alone. So it's not like glorifying the guy like he's some superhero, though he was to me. He was just saying it honestly. I'm sick of this. And he said, Dr. Donner, the one, he goes, I've been witnessing to him. And if I sue, I got to sue him. My daughter's already gone. Why am I going to lose a chance to witness to him? And I sat there and I thought, who are you? I was angry. I was thinking you could pay all your bills off. He had tons of bills from my sister being sick. Pay the house. You got to be kidding me. In the back of my human mind, you know what it said? Make this worth it. You know what my dad said? People got saved. It's worth it. And as this kid, I'm saying, no, because here's the problem. I, as many do, we look at those scenarios and we say, God, why would you allow this? Now, I'm not saying that question is bad. I mentioned this. Asking God why, I think is good based on one thing. You accept the answer. I go to God and say, Lord, what are you doing right now? I don't go to God and say, what are you doing? Because God, how dare you not do it my way? It's what I want to say. But when I go to God, it's not, Lord, why isn't it my way? I say, Lord, what are you doing so that I can get in your path? So that I can find out to be in the center of your will. And right now, I'm lost. But you know what we do? God, how dare you? How dare you allow this? Now we're hurt. But that's kind of where the rubber meets the road. We begin to question his goodness and question his competence. And that's exactly why. Because I'm good enough. I deserve this. You should treat me better because look at all I've done. Now, we may not say that, but part of us thinks that. And that's what the Pharisee said. You know the problem in this situation with the Pharisee is that was the reason he never got saved. Because he based eternity off his own goodness. Can I tell you? And God, as I've read this and studied this and looked it over and thought about it, and God has worked in my heart about it, I am constantly reminded that when God is moving, it's not me figuring out what he's doing so I can ask him to change it. It's me figuring out what he's doing so that I can get in line with what he's doing. If I'm here, it doesn't make sense. Maybe I got to move over here and say, God, this is where you're moving. It's not God moved for me, although he will. I can go boldly before the throne of grace and find mercy and obtain grace to help in time of need. I can go to God boldly and pray. But ultimately, I must submit to the God of this creation, of my soul, and say, Lord, it's yours. And be willing to follow that. Think about the conclusion of this story. Jesus, the storyteller, the great storyteller, deliberately leaves the older brother in an alienated state. The older brother never goes. When he's done telling the parable, the older brother doesn't go back into the party. Think about this. The bad son enters the father's feast. The good son will not. The lover of prostitutes is saved. The man of moral rectitude is still lost. You can almost hear at this point the stories, the Pharisees, they gasp as the story ends. It was the complete reversal of everything they've ever been taught. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. Jesus does not simply even leave it at that. It even gets more shocking. Why doesn't the elder brother go in? He himself gives the reason. He says, I've never disobeyed you, so I won't go in. Literally, the elder brother is not losing the father's love in spite of his goodness, but because of his goodness. It is not his sin that creates the barrier between him and his father. It's his pride and his moral rectitude. It's not his wrongdoing, but his righteousness that is keeping him from sharing the feast of the father. By the way, pride, moral rectitude, it's all sin. That's what we miss. We miss that what was happening in this story. Jesus looks at the prodigals. He looks at the sinners. He looks at the publicans, at the people the religious people hated. And he loves them, and he sees people who are hurting because his world has beat them up, and he just wants to show them love. And he's eating with them, and he's teaching them, and this stupid Pharisee comes over and starts criticizing him. So he starts telling three parables, and the end one is, listen, your goodness will keep you out of heaven. That's exactly what happened. You say, how is that possible? You know, the Bible says, Jesus says, I didn't come to bring the righteous to repentance. But who? Sinners. Here's the point. He says, I didn't come to this earth to bring people who think they're righteous and good because they don't need me. They do, but they don't think they need me. So they will end up in hell by their own design because they won't come to me. He said, I came to people who understand their need of salvation. That's why I came. He came to seek and to save those who are lost. And if I am the prison that he found himself in, he didn't recognize it because he was convinced in his goodness. These Pharisees were convinced by a law that wasn't even God's. They'd added all of this junk. They became so powerful. They ultimately placed it upon a cross. Obviously, it was God who did. It was Jesus who placed himself there. But they, in the law, crucified him. And that's how good they were. That's how good they were. And when I look at this, I look at this story and I think to myself two things. It doesn't make a difference which brother you are. Because the key comes down is, either brother, I need Jesus. I need to repent. Here's repentance. Repentance is simply this. I'm acknowledged I'm a sinner. And I know my sin is bad, and I deserve hell. And I want to ask God to forgive me of my sin. That repentance. That's it. I'm sorry. I'm wrong. You can let, well, my past is horrible, or the things I've done is bad. God doesn't care. He knows your past, and yet he still died for you, and he still loves you, and he still wants you to get saved. You say, well, you know what? I'm good enough. I'm fine. Can I tell you, if you're not saved and that's your reasoning, I hope today you'd understand that God loves you. Can I tell you, number two, if you are saved, but somehow the thinking is still hit, God is blessed to have me in this church. We would never actually say it that way, but we think it that way, don't we? Thank the Lord that I get to do this. And man, when I'm out of church, the church falls apart, right? Now, we don't think that, but sometimes, you know, you never know. Oh, well, Pastor, if I'm not done this way, I'm leaving. Okay. We can get so quickly irritated. It's got to be my way. Got to be my way. Got to be my way. Can I encourage you? Church is not about me. Church is not about tradition. Church is not about fitting a mold. You know what church is about? Jesus. It's all it's about. My job is to point you to Jesus in salvation and then point you to back to the Bible in the truth of the Bible. And yes, sometimes it's not easy. I was listening to a preacher online this week. He got halfway through the message and I did what most of you want to do right now. I clicked off, all right? I moved on. He had a little bit too much conviction there. I went back and finished listening, but I sat there like, oh my goodness. You know why? Because sometimes it becomes my job to point out the truth. But here's the point. Why point the truth? Because truth is where your blessing from God will come from. So as a good pastor, what do I want to do? I want to help you and point you to the place of truth because that's where God's blessing is. So you follow, and hopefully, Lord willing, it'll always be this truth, not my truth. Do not listen to my truth. All right, my truth is crazy. Listen to God's truth. Just ask my kids. I got some things wrong with me, all right? This is my truth. This weekend, we had a scenario in our home. We made us a bit perplexed. We were driving home from a wedding, and my kids called, and they're like, hey, the dog's gone. We don't know where he's at. I was like, oh, really? And it had been a couple hours by this point. We get home, we can't find him, and I look on Facebook, and there's this place, there's this group that one of our neighbors found him behind the school, behind our house, and took him home. And by the time I found this out, he'd been sent to the police station. My dog went to jail over the weekend. Preacher's kids, right? So I pick up the phone and I call the guy, the number of the officer, and he says, by the way, there's a $300 fine if you don't have a license and court fees and all this. And I hung up, what license? I didn't know that. I bought the dog from a Amish girl out there. I didn't know that. I'm like, is he worth $500, right? I'm like, what? I'm going to strap him to the tree next time he comes home. What? So I did what every good person did. I bought a license, right there, $8, bought a license. And I went over there, and I'm sitting there, and I'm rehearsing. The police officer says, where's your license? You know, I'm waiting for him to say, you didn't have it since January. And my kids, we're driving over to get it. My two kids are with me, and they're excited, and I'm sitting there, I don't want to do this. I don't want to pay the money. Oh, man, is he worth it? I'm really struggling with it. You know what they told me? In 5 days, we're going to put him in the pound. I'll just find out which pound it is and go buy him again. It'd be cheaper. And I was really... That sounds horrible for you pet lovers. I was contemplating this, all right? So we get there last night, and he pulls up, and he opens the door. Can I see your license? And I thought he meant the dog license. He goes, no, I need yours. I'm like, why? I'm not in jail. He says, no. So he pulls it out, and I'm sitting there waiting, and my kids are like, what are you going to say? You know, what are you going to say if he asks for the dog license? I'm going to give it to him. And what if you're in trouble? I'm going to pay the money. That's all I was going to say. I'm going to pay the money with the dog. So he goes, you got a dog license? I said, I do. And I went to, I showed it to him. He noticed it was brand new. He goes, when they mail you the paperwork, call me. That's what he told me. I was like, yes, sir. Right away, sir. They gave the dog. We walked away, went home. And we chained him in the backyard. All right, you're not. You know, we can look and say, how dare he say this? How dare he say this? In a silly story, we can look back at life. Because you know what happens with that cop? He should have said this, and oh, he pulled me over. Can I tell you, we get so consumed in our life with our goodness that we miss his grace. Years ago, evangelist we had here, I've been trying to get him back, Jake DeAndre, he preached a message. He had a phrase, I don't know really what the message is about. I don't know anything about it, but I remember this phrase, which is better than most people remember our messages. But I remember this one phrase. He says, everything in life is better than I deserve. Everything is better than I deserve. If I see myself the way I should, I deserve hell, and I deserve everything come that way, which means when God blesses, it's better than I deserve. Now, when I see that, then I can come to my God, who, you know what he does? He blesses me immensely when I walk with him. Wouldn't you want that? In the center in the center of God's blessing? Does it mean you're perfect? No. We still sin. We still struggle. And that's why we come back and confess and ask God to forgive us. We're right back in communion with him. I'll never lose my salvation. I'll never lose the gift he's given me, but I'll have a chance to be able to walk with him. Let me ask you, are you here today? Maybe still the younger brother. You need to be saved, the older brother. Either way, here's a simple question. If you died today, would you go to heaven? The Bible says, these things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. You don't have to wonder. Say, well, I'm not good enough. None of that has anything to do with it. The knowledge is simply this. You asked Jesus to save you, and he did. That's all it is. It's that simple. I can give you a lot of scripture to back that up, which we'd love to be able to do. We'd love a chance to share the truth of Jesus with you. Jesus will change your life. Church does not. Religion just not. Jesus can. We love you, Father. We thank you for the privilege to worship you.